my church family and friends. May the grace of God be with you. We will begin with the mission moment today. The Well Church in Mississauga started with a group of only 13 people. They were drawn together by their deep love of Jesus and a desire to share that love with others. Inspired by a vision to become a welcoming place for second-generation immigrants, they developed a style of evangelism and worship that spoke to those they desired to reach. Their community has grown, and it has become a home for many young people. Please pray for the Well Church in Mississauga and the many churches in the Presbyterian Church in Canada that are making space for a new generation of believers. Presbyterian Sharing supports new faith communities. Remember to reach out to Deb Cosford with your recipes for our new Knox Bayfield cookbook. And remember, on the topic of food, to take your food donations to the bin at Trinity St. James. Our sermon today and the wonderful music will be available on YouTube, and there's a link on our website as well as the printed version on the website. Gene Walker will perform the hymns on the organ. And remember to go to the end of the printed materials for the lyrics. Our call to worship. God meets us in our greatest need and satisfies us with divine presence and provision. In gratitude, let us worship the Lord our God. And the assurance of pardon. The God of steadfast love is our refuge and our Savior. In Christ we are healed, forgiven, filled, and transformed. Alleluia. Amen. Our first hymn will be number 651, and it is called Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. And I did a little bit of research on two of the hymns this week. The lyrics for this hymn were written by William Williams. William Williams is called the Watts of Wales. He was born in 1717 near Carmarthenshire. He originally studied medicine but abandoned it for theology. He was ordained deacon in the Church of England but was refused the priesthood orders, and subsequently attached himself to the Calvinistic Methodists. For half a century, he traveled in Wales preaching the gospel. He died in 1791. His two principal works are Hosanna to the Son of David and Gloria in Excelsis. And Jean will lead us in Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer.
Thank you.
us join together in the prayer for illumination. Providing God, by your Holy Spirit, feed us with your word, that we might be filled with the bread of life. Amen. Our readings this morning include Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 to 31, Psalm 145, verses 8 to 9, and then 14 to 21, Romans chapter 9, verses 1 to 5, and the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14, verses 13 to 21. We will begin with Genesis. Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 to 31. The same night Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two maids, his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then the man said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So the man said to him, "What is your name?" And Jacob said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But the man said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. Our reading from the Gospel of Matthew is chapter 14, verses 13 to 21. Now when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." The disciples replied, "We have nothing here but five loaves and two fish." But Jesus said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the five loaves and the two fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds, and all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. May God bless our understanding of this, God's holy word, the word of God. And our next hymn will be number 348, "Tell Me the Stories of Jesus," and I have a little introduction for the hymn. This hymn was written by William H. Parker. Mr. Parker was born at New Bashford, Nottingham in 1845. Early in life, he began to write verses. He joined a General Baptist church and became interested in Sunday schools. He was led to compose hymns for use at anniversaries. "Tell Me the Stories of Jesus," number 348.
Thank you.
the worship service for Sunday, August 2, 2020. Today is the ninth Sunday after Pentecost. Time has been wonky for the last few months. Wonky in the sense that many have struggled to keep track of the day and even the current month. Traditionally, the passage of time is marked in several ways within the church. Our week is marked by our Sunday morning worship. There are preparation periods that lead to a flurry of activity for significant events. Advent leads to Christmas and Lent to Easter. For others, the church year is further marked by regular communion of the Lord's Supper, social events, and annual fundraisers. Our connections develop into relationships and form a community as we progress through each year. Currently, we mark time with the lack of events, the lack of connection. We mark this week as the 20th consecutive Sunday of 2020 that we have not met in the Bayfield Sanctuary. It is an odd and unusual time. It is a time that will be remembered and shaped by the circumstances in which you live. Many are struggling during this time. Some struggle with social isolation, inadequate resources, fear and anxiety, too much time on their hands, and too little structure in their daily lives. The phrase, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, may be a recurring thought in response to this high level of need. The phrase has different meanings for different people. First, I would like to explore the visual image you may have. Now, cowboy boots often have loops at the top of the boot leg so that the boot can be pulled on. Footwear brands like Doc Martens and Blundstone have prominent boot straps as well. But this expression has little to do with real bootstraps. Initially, the expression marked a fellow about his claim regarding a scientific discovery. When I hear this phrase, my thoughts go to the story of the Good Samaritan. There are negative and positive ways of understanding the phrase. It can also mean that you are expected to succeed without any outside help. In other words, self-reliance is the expectation. Some might say, don't try to pull yourself up by the bootstraps, suggesting the challenges in trying to succeed on your own. When this way of thinking becomes part of the general perspective, it can actually be very helpful. When we are expected to succeed on our own, it can be very harmful. Those with financial security may wonder why low-income people can't pull themselves up by their bootstraps. At the same time, people struggling to make ends meet internalize this judgment. It may become entrenched within us, this expectation that we should be able to do it all on our own. Yet it is challenging in the midst of the struggle to pull yourself up, whether in economic security or personal wellness. The expression demonstrates how expectations often fail to take into account the reality of the challenges. Importantly, this concept contradicts the basic teachings within Christianity where we are encouraged to live in relationship within community in helping one another. The journey of our lives and our faith often take us to places we could never foresee. It is in the journey that we discover who we are and who we want to be. We may discover how struggles in life and in faith have allowed us to see more clearly. The scriptures include many stories of how people have dealt with their struggles. This passage in the Gospel of Matthew occurred immediately after the disciples learn of the brutal murder of John the Baptist. They buried him, and then they told Jesus of the murder of his friend. After retreating for a time of prayer, Jesus walks among the large gathering crowd in the desert. He sees their need for help, for truth, for nourishment, for peace of mind, and he is deeply moved. He has compassion for them. As the day was ending, the disciples encouraged Jesus to turn them away, to send them back out to find their own food. They had little to eat, even for their small group. Yet Jesus said to the disciples, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." The disciples replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." In a place far from fast food outlets and grocery stores, mercy appears as fish and bread. At first, there appears to be little food, those 5 loaves and the 2 fish. Imagine all the people from these towns, from their farms, from their homes, suddenly gathering to hear Christ speak, to be healed by him. Staying despite a growing physical hunger, knowing that they were in the presence of the divine. Imagine Jesus walking through the crowd, approaching you and your loved ones. He would know the needs of each person before a word was spoken. Taking those 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and he blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples, in turn, gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left over, 12 baskets full. There was sufficient food to feed the gathered 5,000. But remember, that only counted the men, so the crowd was likely well over 12,000 people. Imagine. Imagine leaving your homes in the early morning because you heard that Jesus had been sighted in your community. Imagine the people of Bayfield and Grand Bend, Clinton and Goderich. Imagine all of those people gathering together to hear him speak and to see him heal. The disciples were surprised by his actions. But we have to remember that they were often surprised by Jesus. He was not what they anticipated. Although he looked like any other man among them, he was completely outside the realm of their experience. The miraculous power of God's love was proven to go beyond the spiritual. It includes everything, even the food that we eat. I wonder about the fear experienced by the disciples in this passage. Perhaps they were afraid of the immense need within the crowd, the spiritual and the physical need. Perhaps they were afraid of their own hunger and dwindling resources. Perhaps they simply wanted time with Jesus away from the crowd and on their own. And then, in our reading from Genesis, we hear of a different struggle. Jacob's physical struggle illuminates his struggle within himself and with God. As often happens, that struggle left a mark, a physical limp. The Hebrew scriptures tell of the continuing story of Jacob. This is the Jacob who cheated his brother and father and then ran away in fear. In this passage, he is on the journey to seek reconciliation with his twin. After 20 challenging years in Haran with his growing family, Jacob sets out to reunite with his family of origin. Jacob has placed his family and household in a safe location for the evening, and then he crossed back over the river where he wrestles with a man. Maybe an angel, or maybe even God, through the night. During the struggle, Jacob claimed his faith and his new sense of self. I wonder how this passage resonates with you as I am speaking and as we are going through the different scenes, dwindling resources, or even the potential of having less, can initiate a sense of self-preservation. Sharing your resources may be a struggle. Asking for help may present challenging barriers. Perhaps there is a yearning for deeper connection with God. Perhaps you could feel the spiritual hunger as a member of that crowd that surrounded Jesus. Perhaps Jacob's struggle touched something within you. This yearning for connection with a loving and forgiving God. You may recall that Jacob is the son of Isaac and Rebekah, the twin brother of Esau. Jacob swindled his brother, and with the help of his mother, he deceived his father. Jacob fled his angry brother who had been cheated out of his birthright. In his journey, Jacob met God in a dream. He listened to God and his life changed. He went to live with his uncle Laban, eventually marrying both of his daughters. The eldest, Leah, had 11 sons, while Rachel would have one son with the help of her handmaid. In today's passage, Jacob and his family were crossing the Jabbok River, a tributary of the Jordan River that flowed through a deep gorge. It would have been a challenge to cross that river with two women, 11 children, and all that they owned. Jacob was taking his family to his homeland in the hope of repairing his relationship with his brother. Generous gifts had been sent ahead to Esau in the hope of assuring him of good intention. Yet Jacob was concerned that Esau would seek to harm him out of retribution. So then he sent his wives and children and all that he had across the river. That evening, Jacob wrestled with this man or angel or God. He persisted through the night. During the struggle, Jacob was injured when his hip was just touched. It was dislocated. This left him with a limp. It is here that he accepts his blessing of a new name, Israel, which means one who has struggled with God and prevailed. Psychologically, this whole story might be understood as Jacob wrestling with an internal struggle with his guilt. Perhaps the anticipation of owning his deceit created a deep panic or anxiety attack. He was facing the reality of meeting his brother for the first time since he had tricked him. Was the struggle in Jacob's mind? Was he wrestling with himself? Traditional Jewish commentators argue that Jacob wrestled with an angel in human form. The Talmud suggests that he may have been Jacob's guardian angel. Can you imagine wrestling with an angel? Physically wrestling even with God? Perhaps the struggle and the wounded hip were a way to remind Jacob of his blessing. Perhaps this indicates that God is willing to participate in our struggles for change within ourselves, for change within our relationship with God. Jacob's understanding of blessing has changed. In the past, he seized the blessing. He manipulated others. To be blessed, he used cunning and trickery. It happened with his brother over a bowl of soup. It happened again with his nearly blind father. Well, in the darkness of this story, we cannot see clearly all of the events. We cannot tell who is who in this struggle. This wrestling match goes on all night. The Greek word for a wrestling match is actually agon, the basis for our word agony, meaning great pain or great struggle. We, it seems, can gloss over all of these stories from the scriptures, especially stories that we have heard again and again. Yet it is important to remember the struggles, the assistance received or given, and the new way of being that is created. It is important to remember the details, the enormity of the crowd, the initial tiny amount of food. It is important to remember the people and their experiences. Such stories help us to comprehend God's compassionate love. Not an abstract compassion, but in real terms of healing and feeling and touching and feeding. God, the ultimate power of the universe, encourages peace in the world, encourages us to find an end to this perpetual hunger that exists, and to develop spiritual connection for all people. We also discover the responsibility that God has entrusted to us. Jesus told the disciples to feed the thousands of people. God does not work alone, but through people, through you and through me. To follow Jesus is to express our faith in action, with love, justice, and compassion toward others. The Gospels tell us that we will meet Jesus in reaching out to the least of our brothers and sisters, our siblings in Christ, the hungry, the thirsty, the imprisoned, the lonely. When Jesus told the disciples to feed the 5,000, the disciples thought, simply impossible. The need was so great and they believed their resources were so limited. Have we not felt the same? When the disciples worked together and followed Jesus, they realized the resources were plentiful. The events that took place on that hillside in Galilee 2,000 years ago were a miracle that is repeated today in the actions of the faithful. In closing, we must remember that Jesus did not say, "Give me those fish and that bread and I will feed them." The disciples discovered that they were able to do more than they thought possible. We are often urged by the Spirit to give them something to eat, but we turn away feeling powerless or fearing that our resources are limited. We struggle to act in faith. We struggle in our relationship with God. In the dark, in the wrestling, we hear our true name spoken. In the darkness, in agony, a new identity is born. It is God who called the patriarchs and matriarchs, Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Jacob. It is God who sent the Messiah. It is God who called Saul on the road to Damascus. God calls each of us by name, knowing our needs, providing all that is necessary, nudging us to do our part. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Praise be to God, the Spirit, and Jesus the Christ. Amen. Our hymn will be, "I'm Gonna Live So God Can Use Me." It is number 648.
Thank you.
time for the offering of our life and labor to God. Your donations to the church are greatly appreciated. The expenses for our faith community continue, even though we are not gathering in the church community. The work of the church continues in so many ways. Thank you for your ongoing support. God has been generous in providing for our needs. Let us give back a portion of what has been given to us. Loving and generous God, you provide for us and bless us in more ways than we can number. We give to share our blessings. May these gifts be multiplied to tell of your wondrous and steadfast love. Amen. And we will now go to the prayers of the people. You are encouraged to share your concerns and celebrations within the congregation. Your requests will be shared in the prayers of the people and kept in my daily prayers and the prayers of our congregation. Let us pray for all people and all of God's creation. Let us join together in prayer. And at the end of this prayer, if you would like, you can give voice to the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Compassionate God, you are good to all. Help us to trust in you and to share what we have with the hungry world. We pray for your church universal, that our relations with other religions may be respectful and abounding in steadfast love. Enable us to join with people of all faith to work for the well-being of your children. We pray for the earth and all the creatures who look to you for their food in due season. May we do our part in restoring the balance of your creation and deepen our commitment to follow Jesus in ministries that feed and serve others. We pray for all the people of this world, God, for their ethnic groups, nations, and leaders. We pray that wars will cease, that the hungry will be fed, and that refugees will return home in safety and peace. We pray for all those who suffer from physical and mental illness, for all who wrestle with you for personal identity and spiritual peace. May they find their truth. Almighty God, there are many within our church family in need of your care at this time. We lift up Ron, Sandy, and their family as Ron continues his treatment. We lift up Mark for your ongoing care. We lift up Brenda, Mark, and family as they mourn the deaths of Evelyn and George. We lift up Grace as she mourns the death of her mother, Annie. We lift up Jan's sister, Peggy, as she continues to heal from surgery. We lift up Betty Lou as she deals with health concerns, and we lift up her daughter Bonnie as she enjoys the peace of remission. We lift up Jessie as she deals with chronic back pain. We lift up Jessie's daughter Marlene as she continues to heal. We lift up Suzanne and family as they mourn the death of Susan. We lift up Gail's granddaughter Courtney and great-granddaughter Kyla. We lift up Rob, son of Jane and Jim. We lift up Bonnie as she heals. Gracious and merciful God, abounding in steadfast love, we join our voices with all that you have made in speaking your praises and blessing your name. For with Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, you are just in all your ways and kind in all that you do. O Holy One, although we are apart and cannot lift our voices, together we speak the words that Christ taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our final hymn will be number 496, Thy Word is a Lamp Unto My Feet. Number 496. Touched, changed, called, and empowered. Go now in the power and provision of Christ to heal the sick, to feed the hungry, and to serve the world. Christ himself, who holds you in his hands, has blessed you, broken you, and given you as a gift to the world. May the grace of Christ be multiplied to you and through you now and forevermore. Amen.